I want to start off by showing you a picture of my school, my first school that I was at. Some of you may recognize it. It was based on the open classroom model. Some of you are familiar with that. It was very popular a few years ago. See, spending 16 years in the principalship, I equated every year to a dog year, so you have to multiply it by 7. That's why I look this old. You know, who am I and why am I here? Well, I'm here because I was invited to be here. And it's a pleasure to be here. But I wanted to give you a little bit about my background, and I think it's pretty ironic that I'm at a language conference. I'm going to take you back to the early 1960s. And many of you probably weren't around in the early 1960s. I find fewer and fewer people who are each day I get older. It was the last day of fourth grade in 1962. And Miss La Scola was my teacher. She was a first-year teacher. She had those glasses like this. Little diamond things in the corner. You know, you remember. Sorry, you don't remember. You saw pictures of them. But, and hair that kept going north, right? It was the last day of fourth grade, and she announced where everyone was going for fifth grade. And she always, you know, it'd be groups of students. You know, you three are going to have Miss So-and-so, and you three are going to have Miss So-and-so. And she saved me for last. And in front of the whole class, she announced, said, "Stephen, you're repeating fourth grade. You're going to have Mrs. Kelly next year." Well, from that day forward, I was known as the redheaded retard. I had more hair, and it was redder. But I was a non-reader. We all know the data on non-readers in fourth grade. Oh, my gosh, you don't have a prayer. Well, remember the reading groups? Remember, if you were like any kind of bird that was blue or red, you knew you were in the, you know, the elite group. You got the best, you know, you get the beanbag chairs, you got the clean room, you got the new books. Well, I was in the other end of the spectrum, Barbie Williams and I. Barbie Williams and I sat in the other corner and colored. We were in the bird droppings group. We were farther down the food chain. So it was surprising that I didn't learn to read because all I did was color. But there was a time then when it was a lot of fun to work with the high-achieving students. Because in education, a lot of times I find educators who say, you know, I really do well with the upper-end kids. Yeah, that's shocking. You got 8 kids in an AP honors class, and you do really well with them. I think a whole lot of people could do well with them. You know? See, my measure of the success of a school is how we deal with the bottom 20 kids in the school, not the top 20. You know, it's easy to be successful with the top 20. Somebody said, well, I wrote that kid a letter of recommendation. He got into this school, that school. I know. You know what? He was getting in whether you wrote him a letter or not. See, it's like going to a doctor, and if the doctor only said, I only take care of healthy people. I don't take it. So you're sick? Go somewhere else. I only take healthy people. Well, what kind of message would that send? It's like going into school and say, well, I only take the readers, non-readers. And you know what they said? You know what the kid, they said, you know what Miss La Scola said to my parents? He just doesn't try hard enough. And you know what we did in spelling? For everyone you got wrong, if you got them all right, you sat in the front row. So we reconfigured our seats. You got one wrong, you went in the second row. You went in the third row. I was 3 classrooms down. I actually spent no time in my own classroom. But you think about what that does to someone's self-esteem. Now, fortunately for me, there was someone like you, like all of you, a teacher. There was a woman who lived across the street from us, Buffalo, New York, who was a retired teacher. Now, she was probably in her late 50s. I thought she was like, you know, 100. And she took me under her wing that summer and taught me how to read. She stayed with me till 10th grade of high school, because it took a long time. But you know what? I remember going into her house the first time that summer, and she had the old SRA reading series. Anybody remember that? Remember SRA? She had it sitting next to her chair in her living room. Now, later on in life, I realized that she must have ripped that off from the school. I mean, who has an SRA reading series sitting in their living room? I was eyeing those new language series in the back, though. I thought maybe I'll slip one out. If it wasn't for Mrs. Howell, I don't believe I'd be standing here in front of you right now. And later on in life, they discovered some dyslexia, and, you know, I'm ADD times 10 to the 23rd. So it's amazing I'm standing behind the podium. I'm doing pretty well, actually. You can see I'm clinching it, you know. It's pretty soon you see the podium going both sides, and around the room, but it was interesting. I finally got out of fourth grade. You know what? When you do fourth grade the second time, what do you think happens? back in 1962. Nothing. You do the exact same thing and they go, wonder why doesn't he get it? It's like screaming at a deaf person. Why can't they hear me? You're not going to get it. But I did think about it. Which class do you think I excelled in? P.E. P.E. I was, you know, a year older. I was faster than everybody. I won all the races. I figured 2 more years in phys ed, I'd been able to take the teacher in wrestling. But people often ask me about retention. For me personally, there has nothing in my life scarred me more than that experience. I am the wrong person to ask about retention because you'll get an earful. Because I take it from a personal perspective. The next year, fifth grade, or when I finally got in fifth grade, teacher said, weren't you retained in fourth grade? Oh, geez, I'd forgotten. I'd completely forgotten about that. Thank you for reminding me. It was like an albatross you wore around your neck, and it was always there. I really had not talked about it until about 5 years ago. I couldn't talk about it. It was too emotional. My parents never talked about it. It was a very, very tough situation. But finally, I went on and got out of high school, went on, went to college, and had some success there and became a teacher. I taught elementary, middle, high school. I've taught at the university, 2 universities, University of Connecticut, George Washington University, as Jenny said. And, you know, throughout that experience, I've learned a lot. I've learned a lot about what is good and what is great. And my experience is when I went as a principal to Hartford, we were in a situation that was definitely a poor situation. Anybody from Connecticut? Okay, whereabouts? Greenwich, okay, down on the South Shore. Well, I started off as an administrator in a small community that had more cows than people in Connecticut in the 80s. Then I went to the University of High School and became a principal of the highest achieving school on paper in the state. We are a 2-time Blue Ribbon Award winning school. We had highest average SAT scores in the state. You know, our kids were like, you know, our teachers were like junior professors. We were right on the campus of the University of Connecticut. But we had problems there. What do you think some of the problems were? Drugs. On a university campus, drug problems. High incidence of cheating. Why do you think there's high incidence of cheating? Because your parents expect you to get an A. These kids were read to in the womb. From there, I went to Hartford and became principal of the lowest performing school in the state. We had a 28% dropout rate. My first year there, we had more girls give birth to babies than kids graduated from high school. We had a school-based health center there. 3 out of 4 girls who went in for a pregnancy test tested positive for an STD. I didn't shake anybody's hand when I was there for 10 years. a lot of Lysol. You think about that. My first meeting with my faculty, you know what they said? It's good to have a high dropout rate. Those kids don't take our tests. I said, let me tell you a little secret. We could have the squirrels in the trees take the test, and we wouldn't do any worse. We are last. Did you understand? We are dead last. In 10 years, we raised our test scores every year. We took our dropout rate from 28% to 1.8%. But see, when people cannot come up with a solution, they come up with an excuse. And it's easy to come up with an excuse why you can't be better. I look at this hotel, and do you think you get good service at this hotel? Everyone you talk to, everyone you speak to, good morning, how are you, how can I help? I was printing out my boarding pass, and this lady spent I don't know how much time helping us figure it out because we were entering the wrong number. I mean, so hospitable. But why can't every hotel be like that? Why not? Why isn't it? Because it's a choice. Why are there some great schools in America and some other schools that struggle? Because it's a choice. It's a choice we make. It's a choice that the people who walk into that organization, into that building, make every day.